question. When you walk in the front door, now why in the world would there be a door right next to the door that you enter?
Right.
So the Wisters really incorporated a bunch of their own customs, you know, with building the house in keeping with their own German background. So this door here is referred to as the death door. You only leap through this door in your casket. You don't come and go through it, you just come and go through that little door. Chances are, actually, folks would come and go, they might enter through the gate, the driveway gate, on the horse and bug in, and then park in the back, and then enter through the back door here, which you'll see. But this door, real special, you don't want to come and go through this door.
Because they laid you out in one of the rooms, right?
Often under this, so it would be sort of, you know, rites of passage, right? Weddings,
yeah.
Funerals.
Right.
Yeah, special sort of somber room, maybe a room for, you know, entertaining guests as well, but you know, just a room for that. Okay, so let's back up just a minute. So it was John Wister that followed his brother Caspar over here, and that would have been in, say, like 1729 or so. He was a young guy, about 19, coming over from Germany. He first bought property down on Market Street. You're heading downtown earlier, you said?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So around 3rd and Market, which is now, which was then referred to as, I think, High Street was the name of the main road that went back and forth on High Street, but Market Street today. And on the property was blackberries. So he harvested all the blackberries and became a wine merchant. So that's what his background is in wine. He also used part of the land and built his own little house. So he and his family lived there. And then the other area of the property he bought, he built a house to rent. And one of his tenants was Benjamin Franklin.
Oh.
So in the next room I'll show you the little lease from that. So they lived downtown Philadelphia. He was a wine merchant. Back in those days, coming to Germantown was a lot like having a shore house or a country house, like your vacation house, right? So this was a real special retreat place for the family. First, it was would have been just the tenant farmer house, where they would have been, you know, growing fruits and vegetables, and you know, it was all gardens, you can imagine, as they were building this house here. So lived downtown, then eventually they did live here full time, but not initially. So who here has heard of the Quartering Act? Do you know the Quartering Act?
Sure.
Yeah.
I don't remember what it was.
Yeah, yeah, well that's the thing. So back in the day, you know, imagine the English were fighting the Americans, right, and vice versa. So literally, the British could knock on your door, and since they were here fighting, trying to get this, they could take and stay over and take over your house.
Mm-hmm.
So this house was quartered back during the Revolutionary War. Folks didn't want to have their business plundered, is that the right word, you know, looted in the whole bit, so chances are the family still remained downtown. I think the girls were sent to relatives out in the country. It was a very volatile time during the Revolutionary War around here. But this house was quartered by the British.
So you didn't stay in the house when they were in the military, so you're not going to kick you out.
Well, not in all parts. Like up in Boston, you know, the deal was it was usually one or two soldiers per house, and you had to not only provide them sleep, you had to feed them and do their laundry.
Well,
so it might have been different here.
It was a little different in that Justinian, who was the household at the time, did stay here while the house was quartered and cooked and cleaned and took care of them. So who was Justinian? That interesting sort of name that comes through the tales over the years and even the journal. Justinian was the daughter of John Wister's, one of John Wister's clients out in Lancaster County. And this client said to his daughter on his deathbed, "Go find John Wister when I die, he'll take care of you." So Justinia walked from Lancaster County to Grumblethorpe, knocked on the door here, and John Wister invited and welcomed her in. So she really became part of the family.
Wow.
And so tale after tale, studies and readings and stories is that John was very philanthropic, very generous. The whole family, four generations, you'll see posters in the other rooms of different garden cabarets, like, you know, events that they would host here. Mm-hmm. There is a story that Justinia, again, the house help, baked bread every Friday, and the story goes that even for many years after she passed, that you could smell
the bread.
Bread.
That's a nice story.
Yeah. So, and would feed the poor in Germantown. So.
How nice.
Okay, so I do want to travel around because there's a lot to say, but let me tell you more about another bit of this room, which is I spoke about the quartering act. Now, imagine the battle cry. Up the road at Clifton House, which is about a mile up the road, north of here, on Germantown Avenue. The red coats and the blue coats are fighting. General Brigadier Abney, who quartered this house at the time, heard the battle cry. Not unbeknownst to him, exited through this door.
Never made it back, right?
Never made it back. Oh.
That's the last time he went through the door.
Okay, so you see on the floor here, what is referred to as the bloodstain of General Brigadier Agnew. Now, Justinia scrubbed and scrubbed the bloodstain out, so you can see, you know, like a, you know, more of a stain here. But that, whenever you sort of do a quick Google search of Grumblethorpe, the bloodstain is the bloodstain. So, notice we go from room to room, you're going to see lots of clocks. So there's, you know, just fun little things to take note of. The chairs, like I said, a couple views of what the room might have looked like at a different point in time. There's one picture there on the wall. There's another one over there, hard to see, but someone asked about a chandelier.
Exactly.
So we do send a.
So why is there a knob on the pane on the right? And it's going to.
I'm not positive, but I imagine you'll probably hear me say that from time to time. Probably pretty frequently, I'm not sure. Right? But I imagine it was like a string that you would roll around to lock the curtain in. You know. Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah.
So awesome.
Yeah.
Everything done by hand. Look at how tight the joints are.
Mm-hmm.
That is amazing.
Brian's
that kills me.
I just think it's fascinating that how much you're so gourmet.
And this place is so simple.
That's really, it's like the good country. The
wide wood flooring is amazing. Just.
It's all the original hardwood floor.
So the loom certainly is not a period original, obviously, but it's been used at camp over the years, so we keep it here.
Ooh, nice tea service.
Absolutely.
What's that? Tea sets?
It's nice, beautiful. Yeah, I love the blue.
So we refer to this room as the colonial parlor. Chances are, like I mentioned, families might come through the center driveway gate and enter through this back door here, come in here and be entertained. So TV would push your chairs and such to the side, maybe do a little dancing or not. I mean, the way that we have it set up is, I want to point out are a few things, which is there's this fan right on the table here in front of the candle. Any ideas why that might be there and what that might be used for?
Is it protecting from the fireplace?
Yeah.
Sucking the flame up because everything would go up.
Yeah, that's quite likely as well. Yeah, and then so also remember there was yellow fever and smallpox epidemics, right? So, and that would often be scarring on a woman's face, so vanity, they would cover it up with often makeup that would have wax in it. So that's what we've heard about these shields, like fire shields, or sparks, for safety. that out because the bald eagle would be up there post-revolutionary war. But this... I just love the woodwork and...
Furniture's amazing.
Yeah. Caspar, the brother, came over first. Now, Caspar was he had a glass business, he heard of Glassboro in New Jersey. He was actually one of the first Germans over here in America that set up a glass company. Yeah. So, if you ever get to, what's it called? It's in Millville. There's a real important glass museum there. And if you ever get to that museum, you'll see some original glass from Caspar Oyster. He was sort of the one who defied the king, because at the time, any trades that you would do here, any business that you would do here in America, you had to pay your taxes back to the king. So he defied the king by bringing over some Germans to start his glass business. And I guess they didn't pay the taxes. Anyway, we have a bottle in the other room, but these two bottles are from Caspar Oyster's collection. Question if Caspar and his younger brother John, who is the householder here, worked together in the wine merchant business. We're not sure. It's likely, but we're just not sure. Lovely plate set, tea set, and such. But actually, if you think of it and look at it, it's more what would be referred to as baluster or boat weight. So they would load up the boats with what's kind of like baluster china, in a sense, is what it's referred to as, is the baluster. But I think quite lovely, nonetheless. Yeah. Take note of the clock here. The minute hand and the hour hand. So the way it's been looked at before, it's kind of interesting because the hour hand looks a lot like scissors, and then the minute hand would look like maybe a sword. You hear these stories and you just don't know, but I think it's pretty clever to put it all together. Mm-hmm. So look at the window here, and you're going to take a good tour in the back, but you'll see the building actually goes back. And so we don't have it open now because of camp and all that, but beyond this room is what's referred to as sort of the new kitchen. It's really just the walk area way through back then to what would have been the old kitchen, the winter kitchen. A lot of times, the kitchen is separated from the house, just because it was likely a high probability of fires catching. So they would always have the kitchen removed from the main house. Shall we go to the next room?
Sure.
Okay. How's the pace? Am I?
You're good.
Perfect.
Okay. Anyone needs to use the bathroom, let me know. We do have one in the basement.
You do that just to be able to go to the basement.
Yeah.